Welcome to Vlog 17!
It's gonna be me!
It's me!
It's May! You got that right. Mayday, Mayday! How are you enjoying your bank holiday? I don't really have a job, so it's just like any other day for me. Although I was filming earlier last week, I was doing an episode of EastEnders. Can't really tell you too much about it, but it's part of their Gay Pride celebrations. Yes, EastEnders have built its own gay bar in Walford. And to coincide with London's Pride events later in July, the residents of Walford are gonna take part in their own Gay Pride march as part of an episode. From what I've seen, it looks fantastic. There's gonna be a few storylines. I'm part of one. Definitely check it out. So on Monday, I was at the Dunmar Warehouse to see Sweet Charity. Now, I love this show. I saw it last year when Gemma Sutton was at the Watermill Theatre. And honestly, I was really excited about this production. This show is the last to be directed by Josie Rook after 7 years as artistic director at the Dunmar. And unlike her predecessors, she chose to do a musical rather than a Shakespeare play. So for that, I give her full credit. Like I say, the show's been done recently by Rebecca Traherne in Nottingham and also Gemma Sutton at the Watermill. In this production, they've gone for Anne-Marie Duff, the acclaimed and brilliant actress. But can she sing? Oh, truth be known, her voice did sound a little tired and strained. It's difficult because you can say that it's part of the character. You feel her emotion, you feel her rawness rather than her having an aesthetically pleasing voice. But ultimately it is a musical and you want to hear the music sound good. Or at least I did. So I felt a little bit underwhelmed. But also what I felt about the show in general, it was a bit too stark. It is very gritty, very raw, strips it right back, and that emotion does come through. So the impending ending, I won't spoil it for you, but it does break your heart. Like I say, Anne-Marie Duff is a fantastic actress and she embodies this character fully. But the way I've always seen Sweet Charity is it's a bit of a rom-com. It's hilarious in moments and heartbreaking at others. It's always had that kind of sheen over it. And what Josie Rook has done is lifted that off. It's a very stylized production set in a Andy Warhol style warehouse. And it just wasn't what I wanted. Arthur Darvill is brilliant. His scenes are hilarious. I watched it the day after the fantastic Debbie Krupp ran the marathon. And in spite of that, she was still there on Monday kicking those legs. It was also really nice to see Charlotte Giaconelli and Danielle Steers, who again I would have liked to have seen more of because I think they're brilliant. Also, in a kind of cameo way, they've got a different performer playing Daddy throughout the run. So last week it was Adrian Lester. This week I got to see Legato Chocolat, who is incredible. But he only comes on for one song, so it just seems a bit, oh. Next week they've got Beverly Knight, who I would love to see. The part of Daddy sings the classic Rhythm of Life. Like I say, I didn't hate it. It just wasn't really for me. I just found it a bit too dark. Sorry. It's on until the 8th of June and it is practically sold out. So you might be able to get a few returns on certain dates, but also you can get a standing ticket and stand at the back of the theatre for £10, which is definitely worth doing because it is quite a small theatre and you won't actually miss anything. And if you want to see more of the cast of Sweet Charity, they will be taking over Kinky Cabaret on Monday the 13th. So get yourself there. It will be an incredible evening. So the Tony Award nominations were announced this week, and Hadestown has swept the board. Wow, I honestly didn't really like it, although my friend saw it about 6 times and he loved it. So maybe it's just me. But it is incredible to see Eva Noblezada nominated for Best Actress in a Leading Role. She is incredible. I remember seeing her when she first came over to do Miss Saigon. And when I saw her in Hadestown, she is really, really fantastic. She's in the same category, though, as Stephanie J. Block, who I saw playing Cher in the Cher show last year. And I love that show and love her. So I'll be honest, I'll be happy if either of them take it home. But I really want Steph to. On Tuesday, I saw Man of La Mancha, the E&O's new production for the next 6 weeks. Now, this is quite an obscure piece that hasn't been done in decades. And the E&O have brought it back with no expense spared. The stage and set are incredible, as are the costumes, as are the talent on the stage. The cast is led by American actor Kelsey Grammer and Nicholas Lyndhurst, with Danielle DiNiese and Cassidy Jensen sharing the role. My friend Eugene McCoy also has quite a big part, which I had no idea. He told me he was in rehearsals for the show, but obviously I had no idea what the show was. So yeah, it caught me off guard when he came out and stole the show. He's fantastic. We grew up together in the Northeast before he moved down to come to Arts Ed. He then went on to do shows like Mamma Mia, American Psycho, Groundhog Day, and recently A Christmas Carol. I am so proud of him. He is fantastic and smashes this part. So back to the show. It is one of those where you will be surprised how many songs you actually know from it. And it's enjoyable on that count. It is a bit long and drawn out and does waver at certain points, but buckle in, persevere, and you'll enjoy it. It's a fantastic show. The biggest song that you will know from the show is The Impossible Dream. It is a classic that everybody's done. But this is the first time I've seen it sang in context with the piece. And Kelsey Grammer delivers a fantastic performance. He, like Anne-Marie Duff in Sweet Charity, brings a rawness and an authenticity to the character and the voice, performing it in a way that's genuine. It won't be like anything you've seen sung before, but he does a great job. And he has got a strong voice. I saw him last year when he did Big Fish at the Other Palace, and his voice has definitely improved since then. It is a fantastic show, and the cast were incredible. We had a fantastic time at the after party. I spilled chocolate sauce all down myself and had to wear my overcoat for the rest of the evening. Shame on me. So Rob Houghton and Bradley Jayden have been added to the all-star lineup of Les Mis later this year. Wow, that show is going to be incredible. So I managed to see Fiddler on the Roof this week. I missed it when it was at the Minio Factory, so I was delighted that it's transferred to the Playhouse Theatre. If you don't know the show, it's a stunning show, with some classic songs that, again, you will know. But not only that, it has a real poignance to the story, which is all about change and reform and giving women equality. Andy Nyman is exceptional. His performance is stunning. And again, like I said earlier about Kelsey Grammer and Anne-Marie Duff, he plays it so authentically and draws from the character that you're captivated, honestly. But the difference being that Andy Nyman does have a very exceptionally strong voice, and you could tell. And that makes a difference. When you know someone is capable of singing a song legit, it means that they can make choices within their performances to bring out certain elements. And that is where the talent is. It is a stunning cast, with Judy Kern appearing for the next 6 weeks only. After that, Anita Dobson and Maria Freeman are going to be joining the cast, who I think are incredible actresses. So yeah, if you get a chance and you want to see the existing cast for the next 6 weeks, make sure you get yourself along. If not, go along later in the year to see the pair of them. The set is stunning, and they have redeveloped the Playhouse to incorporate it around the boxes and into the auditorium. Just wait until you see it. You will be amazed. On Wednesday, I popped into Freedom to see Black Girl Magic, Coco Vidoce's cabaret production. If you don't know Coco, she is the alter ego of incredible performer Sean Parkins. Sean is incredible, and along with his dancers Grant and Ian, they put on a showstopper of shows to celebrate May Day. Here's a few little clips from that night. The sky fell out of the sky. The tears will drip to the ocean. And now I'm looking for a reason why.
Better than that. It is May Day, honey. May Day, May Day. Everybody say, hey, Coco.
Hey, Coco.
That's better. What is your name?
Anthony.
Everybody say, hey, Anthony.
So opening this week, I went along to watch Rosamund Schaum. I didn't know this play, but I think it's really good. I did see Hedda Gabler last year at the National. And this, like Hedda, is pretty dark. In this production, you've got screen actors Hayley Atworth and Tom Burke, as well as Olivier winner Giles Torreira, who was fantastic. I only saw Giles in Hamilton, so it's fantastic to see how good an actor he is. And Hayley Atwell is sensational. I felt a little bit that her performance was a bit too modern. She didn't really embody the character of that age. But nonetheless, she's captivating, as is Tom Burke. And the whole ensemble really come together. It is beautifully staged and beautifully lit. And I won't spoil the ending, but wow. That leaves an impression. Again, it's one of these pieces which is about reform and change and empowerment for women. And it's great to see these stories being told, but then surprising that these were written so long ago, and yet, where have we come? Like I say, if you're not familiar with Ibsen, if you think you're not going to enjoy it, surprise yourself. Go along and see what you think. Because I was surprised, and I did enjoy it. So Phoebe Waller-Bridge announced that she is bringing her one-woman show, Fleabag, to the West End. Originally starting out at the Soho Theatre, it then spawned its own TV spin-off, which lasted for 2 seasons, before Phoebe then took it to Broadway, where she is now transferring it back to the West End for a limited run. And it already sold out. I was lucky enough to see the original production with Phoebe years ago, and it is an incredible piece, and she has done so well for herself. As an actress, she was in series like Broadchurch and recently the Star Wars movie. As a writer, she has wrote the universally acclaimed Killing Eve and has just been appointed as co-writer for the next James Bond film. She is smashing it, and quite rightly so. She works hard. I saw a lot of her earlier work, and she is incredible. The production of Fleabag is going to be directed by Vicky Jones, who actually used to mentor me as an actor. I've not booked a ticket, and it now has sold out. But I am told that there will be 33 day seats available every day, plus another 33 tickets to stand at the back of the auditorium. So either way, if you want to go and see it, you will definitely get a chance. And you definitely should, because Phoebe is a tour de force. She's incredible. So finally announced, Stephen Schwartz's new version of A Prince of Egypt is definitely coming to London, to the Dominion Theatre on the 5th of February 2020. This is going to be a new version of the adaptation from the movie, using both music from the film and new music that he has written especially for this production. Also this week, performer Jack Hinton announced on social media that he'd recently had treatment for cancer. He's currently out in Germany in Starlight Express, and the good news is that they managed to catch the cancer, operate, and he's already back at work. It just reminds you how precious life is. I am sending all my love and best wishes to Jack. Get well soon and get back on those skates. So, the ENO have announced that Michael Ball is coming back to take on the part in Hairspray again. If you didn't see him when he first did it, he is pretty damn good. So it should be a fantastic production. I'm looking forward to seeing who else they cast alongside him. Now, with regards to Hairspray itself, the show is actually going to be touring as well next year. So one way or another, it'll be coming to a city near you. It's also been announced that Dame Patricia Routledge is going to be joining the all-star lineup for a concert version of Carousel on the 19th of May at the Cadogan Hall. Wow. On Friday, it was Showreel Share Day. Now, if you're not familiar with this, this is basically an opportunity on social media for people to put up their showreels and not get judged for it. There is a tendency within the industry for people to look down and sneer on other people who are seen to be self-promoting or trying to put themselves up at the end of the day, we all have to promote ourselves and we all have to strive to get ourselves out there. So this is a really nice opportunity just to celebrate and recognise each other and our achievements. And I'll be honest, I shared Steph Parry's because she is incredible. You know I love Steph Parry and you know I love her voice. But her showreel shows just how good an actress she is as well, especially on screen. And that's the point of this, is to share these little videos so we can all get a sense of what we're all capable of. I even shared my own. It's a little bit dusty now. It's about 4 years old, but I thought, why not? And if you want to watch it, here it is. Enjoy. What? £1 million? As if you need it.
Isabel, what did I say in my sleep?
Pushing me, then my back against the wall. What else was I supposed to do?
Tell the truth.
You're my brother, David. I would have thought if anybody would be there for me, it would be you.
Oh, so it wasn't a cover up the fact that you were a dirty little corkhead then? When are you going to take responsibility for your actions?
I like to have a good time, I'm young. It doesn't mean I'm a corkhead.
No? Then what do you need 250 quid for? Why do you need it so bad that when Dad said no, you had to steal it from him?
David, I didn't know what else to do. I was scared shitless. I wasn't thinking straight. They were after me and I...
By them, I'm assuming that you mean dealers.
No, not just dealers. They were going to kill me.
For 200 quid? You're full of shit.
David, I'm not lying. I wouldn't lie about something like this. They were after me and I couldn't tell Dad why I needed it because it'd kill him. And if I didn't get the money, they were going to kill me.
You know what, Peter? You are nothing but a little fucking junkie.
David, don't, please. I need you. You're the only one that understands.
Get your hands off me! Don't you touch me again.
So that's why I look like with hair. Can you imagine? And a very strong Northern accent. Anyway, thank you very much to Leon Lopez, who now directs Hollyoaks, and John Pickard, who was in Hollyoaks, who both produced that film for me. And while I'm talking about this, I just want to give a big shout out to my friend Christopher D. Clegg. I talked about him last week because he's a producer of Gals Aloud and the Spice Girls. But he also produces his own drag show, Rosie Beaver. Now, Chris had a show scheduled for the Underbelly next week and admitted on social media this week that he was forced to cancel the show due to anxiety that he was feeling in the build-up to the show. Now, this is a real shame. I really respect and admire Chris for coming out about this. For anybody to put themselves out there and to put themselves up to be judged. I admire anybody who puts a show together because as a performer it is so exposing, and especially when it's your show. And bless Chris. Chris is an incredibly talented human being and one of the funniest people I know. So I really send all my love to Chris and respect, and I can't wait to see him back on the stage when he feels comfortable. Now, talking again about putting yourself out there and exposing yourself, I was honoured to be invited by Emily Moody and Pete Moody for their workshop production of Parenthood. They are young parents who have written a piece all about parenting. And you know what? I quite enjoyed it. It is a musical review which they presented at the Actors Church in Covent Garden. Now, the Actors Church is a bit of a tricky venue because the acoustics and sound were an issue. There were moments where you couldn't quite hear what the performers were singing, which was a shame because it sounded incredible. Now, music reviews are a bit of an odd one. I never really see them as productions. I always see them as a starting point for composers. Now, most composers start out by writing song cycles and music reviews before going on to write full productions. So in this case, it's no exception. These are two new composers trying out new work, getting it out of there, and like I said about Showcase Show Day, this is exactly why we do this. To be bold and to be brave and to expose ourselves and put things out there to be judged. And I'm not going to judge it because it is a work in progress, but I will say the production values were incredible. I talk a lot about production values because even when I see full productions, sometimes they lack any attention to detail. Now with this, the set was simple and clean and brilliant. The costumes were all aligned to the extent that they even matched up the pictures within the program to the actual costumes they were wearing on stage, which is a really nice attention to detail. And the program itself was really beautifully presented. And this is a feel-good show with lots of heart. Everybody taking part was giving so much energy. I was really impressed. I think they've done a really, really good job. Well done. On Saturday afternoon, I went to see Amour at the Charing Cross Theatre. Now, I was supposed to go and see it next week, but because Jack Reitman was on, I decided to go and see a preview. Jack went on after Daniel Stockton was taken ill. Now, Jack is a performer who I met recently after graduating from Royal Academy of Music. We actually met at the Charing Cross Theatre when we were both there for the press night of Harold and Maude. Jack was then a guest of a producer who we both know. So it's incredible that a year later, he's now performing at this theatre. He has an incredible voice. So, this show on paper looks incredible. It has some of my favourite people in it. Now, leading the cast is Gary Tushaw and Anna O'Byrne. Now, both have appeared at the Charing Cross before. Gary was in Ragtime and Anna was in The Woman in White. I've also seen Gary at the Suffolk Playhouse in Allegro. As well as that, we've got the incredible Alyssa Churchill and Keith Ramsey. And Claire Machin, who I saw in Flowers for Mrs. Harris. Amour is written by Michael Legrand, who was nominated for 13 Academy Awards. And this production was done once before on Broadway in 2002. However, it only lasted for 31 previews and 17 performances before closing. Doesn't bode very well. Keeping the seating arrangement from Violet at the Charing Cross Theatre, this production is again presented with audiences on both sides, which, like Violet, I don't understand what it lends to the production, other than it makes the cast have to work even harder and the direction difficult. It's directed by Hannah Chiswick, and to be honest, I didn't find... Now, as a production, it's a bit of an odd story about a man who discovers the ability to walk through walls and then faces a moral dilemma of having this ability. I'll be honest, the music just didn't grab me. Especially when you're watching somebody like Claire Machin and remembering how good Flowers for Mrs. Harris was and how authentically French that felt. With this piece, I didn't really feel that we were being taken to France. I think they could have done a lot more. It's directed by Hannah Chiswick, and to be honest, a lot of what she was doing is stuff that I'd seen done before. The cast was sat at either side of the stage on chairs, pulling the chairs in, using them as devices. It's nothing new, I'm afraid. Having said that, the cast are great. But yeah, I just didn't feel anything. It is choreographed by Matt Cole, who did an incredible job with Fiddler on the Roof. But again, having seen that earlier in the week, this just doesn't measure up. The overall feel is that you're watching a... And I don't mean it's derogatory, but it feels like you're watching a drama school grad show rather than a West End production. And I think that's the combination of all the elements. It just doesn't pop, unfortunately. On Sunday, I travelled down to Brighton to watch The Milkman's On His Way, a new gay play, part of the Brighton Fringe. Adapted by Kevin Kelly, based on a book by David Rees, it's directed by Tim MacArthur and stars Lucy Penrose, who I know from Judy. It is a nice coming-of-age story about a young gay man growing up in the 80s and discovering his sexuality. The problem with it is that it's nothing original or groundbreaking. With incredible plays like The Inheritance and Riot Act recently, this just didn't tell me anything new. It is an enjoyable piece, thanks in part to the 80s soundtrack, which they've got spot on. But other than that, I felt some of the writing was a bit contrived and unrealistic. And some of the staging was a bit awkward. But generally, it was a really nice piece. Now, I finished off the weekend watching The Roles We'll Never Play, a cabaret presented by Tom Juerne with a whole cast of incredible performers. And I will leave you with a selection from that night. See you next time.
Switching on a light bulb. Watch the juice begin to flow.